Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Pleasure to welcome Sungjin, and this paper is going to appear in SICOM. It's about routers that use GPUs. Thanks.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Sungjin Han, and I'm going to present PacketShader, our GPU-accelerated software router. This work is joint work with Gwon Jang, Kyung Spark, and my dear advisor, Sumun. Let me explain what PacketShader is all about. PacketShader is a software router that exploits GPU for high-performance database processing. Our PacketShader prototype shows 40 gigabits per second forwarding performance on a single PC. I'm going to give a general idea of software routers. A software router is literally driven by software, so inherently flexible and programmable. The role of software router is not limited to IP routing. If you want more functionalities or support of new protocols, then you can just do it by modifying software. Software routers are based on commodity hardware, which has two implications. Commodity hardware is cheap, and its evolution is much faster because it's backed by millions of customers. Now, let's review the commodity hardware market. 10 gigabit NIC has become popular, and this is a great opportunity for software routers. The cost of 10 gigabit port is dropping quickly, and it's now below $300 per port. You can build a multi-tenant software router at a very affordable price. However, a high-speed link at low cost does not guarantee the performance of software routers. The Achilles heel of software routers has long been its low performance. The table in the slide shows the performance of software routers measured with 64-byte package. Many researchers have tried to push the performance to the limit, but it has not scaled beyond 10 gigabits per second. This means that it doesn't matter how many 10G ports you have, your system will not be able to handle even a single port at a line rate. The performance bottleneck is in the CPU, and I'm going to give you a little more details. Let's see how much computation power is needed and why CPU-only approach is not enough for 10G networks. First of all, you need 1,200 CPU cycles to receive and transmit packets through network interface cards. Furthermore, you need additional computation power depending on what you want to do on the software router. The problem is that you don't have enough CPU cycles. So how can you solve this problem? Yeah.
CPU cycles, they must be with respect to a certain specific architecture, right? Like of instruction set. So what is this, x86 or?
Yeah, digit numbers are based on x86. And unfortunately, Linux. So our approach is twofold. The first one is to optimize packet I/O, and we got significant improvement by a factor of 6. I'm not going to address the details in this talk, and you can find our optimization techniques in the paper. And our second approach is about how to handle these application-dependent operations in an effective way. Our solution is to offload those operations to GPU, and this is the main topic of this talk. I assume most of you are not familiar with GPU, so let me introduce GPU briefly. GPU is the central processor in a graphics card. In order to synthesize realistic 3D graphics in real time, GPU handles millions of polygons and billions of pixels per second on its massively parallel architecture. Software routers have nothing to do with graphics rendering. Then why am I introducing GPU to you guys? Recently, GPU has been flexible and programmable enough for non-graphics workloads. So general purpose computation on GPU is increasingly popular. And basically, this work is a novel application of GPU per software routers. GPU architecture is different from that of general purpose CPU. Today's CPU has a small number of cores, and each core is quite fast. In contrast, GPU has a large number of cores, and each GPU core is not as smart as CPU cores. They don't have some advanced features of CPU, such as out-of-order execution or dynamic branch prediction. If you want to transport a few people quickly, then CPU is the best option. But if you want to transport so many people, in other words, if your workload is throughput-centric, then you should consider use of GPU. This difference comes from how transistors are composed in the processor. CPU dedicates most transistors to execution control plane and large caches to accelerate single-threaded programs. GPU has much more transistors in general, and most of the transistors are devoted to arithmetic logic units, and these arithmetic logic units form a large array of GPU cores. So if your workload has enough parallelism, you can expect significant throughput improvement with GPU. Now let's move on to how we can utilize GPU for packet processing. For packet processing, GPU can be a quite effective solution. I'm going to explain the advantages of GPU in terms of low computation power, memory access latency, and memory bandwidth. Software routers need lots of computation power. Hashing, encryption, pattern matching, all these operations are computation hungry. The good thing of GPU is that it has much higher computation power. So you can adopt those compute-intensive operations in your software router. And the second aspect is about memory access latency. Software routers tend to do random memory access, so your CPU will experience lots of cache misses, and thus wasting partition computation power. In contrast, GPU can work around memory store penalties. When the GPU has a cache miss, then it switches to another thread that is immediately executable. This context switching is done by hardware scheduler, so it does not cause any extra overhead. And the last thing I want to compare is memory bandwidth. The memory bandwidth of top-of-the-line CPUs is 32 gigabytes per second today, and this number is theoretical, and depending on memory access pattern, you will get much less empirical memory bandwidth. So you can't utilize even this number because you have many mouths to feed. Basically, reception and transmission of packets through NICs take a large amount of memory bandwidth. If your software router forwards traffic at a certain rate, then the memory bandwidth consumption is more than four times. As a result, your budget for packet processing can be less than 10 gigabytes per second on high-speed networks. Within the budget, you have to make a porting decision or perform deep packet inspection for every packet. The problem is that your remaining budget is not quite enough to handle such memory-intensive operations. The good thing is that GPU has an order of magnitude higher memory bandwidth than that of a CPU. So if you offload memory-intensive operations to GPU, then you can secure enough memory bandwidth. So far, I have explained why GPU can be useful for packet processing. Now I'm going to explain how to use GPU for packet processing. The basic idea of using GPU in software router is very simple. The CPU's role of receiving and transmitting packets through NICs remains as a traditional software router. The difference is that we offload core operations to GPU. Such operations could be, for example, forwarding table lookup, encryption, or anything that requires much processing power. One thing you have to consider is, as I said before, GPU is basically for parallel processing. For optimal performance, you must feed enough parallelism to GPU. Otherwise, GPU is going to be underutilized, so you can't expect any performance advantages over CPU. Then, where can you find such parallelism in packet processing? We can take multiple packets from RxQs in a batch, not one by one, and process them in parallel. The key insight behind this work is that stateless packet processing is easily parallelizable by definition. You don't need any coordination between packets for parallel processing. Some of you might worry that accumulating hundreds of packets may induce unreasonable delay. Our answer to the question is, it's not true. For example, on a fully saturated 10G link, you can gather up to 1,000 packets only in 67 microseconds. Now let's move on to the detailed architecture of PacketShader. PacketShader's basic design is very simple. The packet processing is done in three stages: pre-shader, shader, and post-shader. And I'm going to explain how each stage works. This is an example of IPv4 forwarding. Once packets are received in a batch, the pre-shader stage performs some pre-processing of packets, such as checksum and TTL check or whatever. Some packets that need slow-path processing go to the default TCP IP stack of the operating system. For the last package, pre-shader collects the destination IP addresses of the package and pass them to the shader stage. In the shader stage, the collected IP addresses are copied to the GPU, and the GPU performs porting table lookup in parallel. And finally, the resulting next hop information is delivered to the CPU again. Finally, in the post-shader stage, the packets are updated and transmitted through outputs based on the forwarding decision result. For simplicity, I omitted the device driver in the previous slide, but of course you need an interface to communicate with network interface cards, as in the figure. We implemented our own device driver for optimal performance, and you can find some details in the paper. So far, we have been, we have seen the basic design of PacketShader, but things become a little more complicated because of some challenges behind today's commodity PC architecture. The first challenge comes from adoption of a multi-core CPU. Recent CPUs have multiple cores in the die, and each core must run as independently as possible in order to achieve linear scalability with the number of cores. So we duplicated the basic streamline across multiple cores, as shown in the slide. Another choice we made is to dedicate one CPU core as a master core, which communicates with the GPU. When multiple cores contend for the same GPU, the system performance significantly drops. So this is the reason why we have only one master core in the CPU. For commodity x86 servers, multi-CPU configuration has become increasingly popular. The challenge of multi-CPU systems is that the cost of communication between separate CPUs is very expensive. So we partitioned the PacketShader system in a way that any communication between the master and workers can be done only in the same CPU. Now let's move on how we evaluated the system and what performance numbers we got. This is how we set up our PacketShader prototype. We used two quad-core CPUs, four dual-port 10 GNICs, and two GPUs in the system. The intention of why we used multiple components in the system is, first, to prove that PacketShader is really scalable, and second, to confirm that our system reflects the trend of top-of-the-line commodity servers. For measurement, we connected a packet generator and packet shader back-to-back. We built the packet generator, which is based on our highly optimized packet I/O engine. It can generate up to 80 gigabits per second with minimum sized UDP package. And here is the result. We implemented four applications, IPv4 and V6 forwarding, OpenFlow switch, and IPsec tunneling on top of PacketShader. This graph compares our CPU only and CPU plus GPU implementations, clearly showing that effectiveness of GPU per packet processing. The speed up due to GPU acceleration depends on applications. For IPv4, which is simple enough already, you can't expect much improvement with GPU acceleration. In contrast, IPv6 shows 4.8 times improvement over CPU-only implementation because IPv6 forwarding is highly memory intensive, so GPU can help a lot.
How did you manage to get 28.2 gigabits per second in CPU? I thought you told me the beginning the max was under 10, and the memory bandwidth was also roughly 10.
Memory bandwidth is the bottleneck in this case, but I can say the memory bandwidth we need is 8 gigabits per second because it's about gigabits per second, and the numbers I said is about gigabytes per second. In this talk, I'll give you more details of IPv6 and IPsec offloading as examples. The first example is IPv6 forwarding. IPv6 table lookup requires more processing power than IPv4 because IPv6 address is 128-bit long, which is 8 times longer than IPv4 addresses. So we offloaded the longest prefix matching operation to GPU. The algorithm we used in our work performs binary search on hash tables. Here is the performance result of IPv6 forwarding. The performance improvement of GPU is clear when the packet size is small. And our GPU acceleration guarantees around 40 gigabits per second for any packet sizes. I told you that the total capacity of our system is 80 gigabits per second, but for both CPU-only and CPU plus GPU cases, the throughput does not scale beyond 40 gigabits per second. This is because of the hardware problem in our motherboard, and details are again in the paper. We expect much higher performance once the hardware problem is fixed. And the second example is IPsec tunneling. IPsec tunneling is done in two stages. In the first stage, the entire packet is encrypted with AES algorithm. And in the second stage, hash-based message authentication code is appended with SHA-1 algorithm. We offloaded AES and SHA-1 algorithms to GPU because these cryptography operations are highly computer-intensive. For IPsec, GPU acceleration improves the throughput by a factor of 3.5. You can see that the performance improvement is stable for all packet sizes. This is because IPsec operates on entire package, not only on packet headers. For minimum size package, PacketShader runs at 10 gigabits per second, and its performance reaches up to 20 gigabits per second for large packet sizes. And I can say this number is comparable or much superior to commercial hardware-based IPsec tunneling appliances. Let me compare our system with previous software routers. PacketShader is the first multi-tenant software router on a single machine. And with GPU acceleration, PacketShader runs at the speed of 40 gigabits per second. What's interesting here is that previous software routers were implemented in kernel, not in user space. The common belief has been that user-level packet processing, despite its many advantages, is much slower than kernel-level packet processing. In contrast, we implemented PacketShader in user level and shown that high-performance packet processing is possible in user space.
The number you had there for outputs is for minimum size packets, right? 64.
Right.
Otherwise, they may make your 28.2 Gbps as well. But at least that's what the CI paper seems to say. For 1500 byte packets, their CPU-only implementation gets you.
Yeah, for larger packet sizes, due to our I/O bottleneck, it shows the same performance. But what I want to say is that in GPU implementation, it guarantees 4 gigabits per second performance for any combination of packet sizes. I'm going to conclude this talk. I have shown that GPU is a great opportunity for software routers. We realized the GPU idea in the PacketShader, and PacketShader is a scalable software router that exploits GPU for packet processing acceleration on top of optimized packet I/O engine. We implemented four applications IPv4 and V6, OpenFlow, and IPsec on PacketShader to prove the effectiveness of and flexibility of our system. Here is the list of our plan to extend PacketShader. The first one is to integrate control plane in PacketShader. Our current implementation only supports static forwarding table for IP routing, and we are planning to integrate Quagga or JORP in our system. And second one is about programming environment. We are planning to support clean-like modular programming environment to make our system more extensible. And the third one is to support the concept of opportunistic offloading. If the volume of input traffic is low enough, then we may use only CPU for low latency and low power consumption. And if the traffic goes up, then we can use GPU for high throughput. And this is the end of my talk, and I would be happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
So you do batch processing, right? I mean, you hold the packets in a buffer, look up their IP addresses, yeah. And so that adds some delay. How much delay do you need? I mean, I was expecting to see some sort of a graph that showed a trade-off between throughput and the extra delay that you added.
Yeah. Usually, we collect hundreds or thousands of packets, but the delay is acceptable. And this graph shows the round-trip latency measured with PacketShader, and you can see that the CPU plus GPU implementation shows the latency between 200 microseconds and 400 microseconds. This may be not trivial so for some people, but I think it's acceptable. And if I can implement the opportunistic offloading idea, as I said, then the latency graph will look like this.
So one more for bottleneck is the PCI Express bus. So it seems like you'll be bound by the rate at which you can transfer data to the graphics card and back.
And the problem is that this is how our system looks like, and there is something called IOH between CPU and GPU, can see, and IOH basically bridges some devices to CPU, and in our mainboard we have two IOHs because we needed lots of PCI Express slots in our systems. The problem is that if we have two IOHs in the mainboard, then the IO throughput in our system does not work well as it's supposed to be. Sue, I think I need your help.
We actually played with a single IOH case, and with a single IOH case, put three network interface cards. Okay, we actually have performance more than 50 gig. But when we have dual IOH on our system, then the performance is planned to. It's actually not only the reception part, receiver side, that's bottlenecked at 40 gig. Mm-hmm. So our packet generator can spit out packets at 80 gig, but cannot receive, basically take the packets from the NIC and touch memory at 80 gig. It's capped at 40 gig. So I think it's a dual IOH, the controller problem, Intel controller problem, and it's been reported in other user groups. And we're just waiting for the next generation IOH from Intel.
But even if that's fixed from the IOH to the GPU, that communication is happening over the PCI Express bus, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
How much benefit do you think you'd get if you actually take the processors from the GPU and put them on another core on the actual CPU die itself, so you didn't have to go over the memory bus to go between the CPU and the GPU?
So you mean how about putting more CPUs rather than GPUs, right?
No. I mean actually putting vector processors like you have on the GPU into the actual CPU die. They take away, you know, an extra core.
You mean something like AMD?
Yeah.
What I wanna say is GPU in this world may be transitional, and maybe some CPU plus GPU in an integrated form may be the final destination, I think. But today, the separate chip graphics card is the best way to have some performance advantage over CPU, because GPU consumes lots of power and it dissipates lots of heat. Maybe I think in some day, it's going to be realized that CPU and GPU can be together.
Yes, but my question was, how much is the memory bandwidth currently to the GPU currently bottlenecking your system? Do you think that's actually a significant factor or not?
Maybe I think I don't understand.
The PCI Express bandwidth, so from the NIC, first it's loaded to the RAM, and then from the RAM to GPU, and then back to the RAM. And so GPU...
So you have an extra back and forth.
Yes, double copy.
That you wouldn't need if you didn't have that.
Which is why as your packet size goes up, the differential.
But the important thing is that
in the first place where you had the different pieces eating up parts of it.
So depending on the processing, you don't need to copy the entire packet. If for the forwarding, you only need the address to the GPU.
Right.
So for IPsec, you need the entire packet. That's
right.
So it depends on the application.
For your CPU numbers, did you take advantage of SSE instructions?
What kind of
instructions? SSE instructions.
SSE. Yeah, basically, we could use SSE for our implementation because our implementation is done in user level. And in user level, we can use SSE instructions. You can't do it in kernel level implementation. But basically, we didn't use SSE instructions because it needs lots of work and some expertise in the instruction. And the same story can be applied to GPU, but our GPU implementation is just straight porting of CPU program to GPU. So maybe SSE instructions can help, but the performance bottleneck of CPU implementation of IP forwarding is something about memory access latency, not the number of instructions. So SSE, I don't think SSE would help a lot.
What did you use for programming the GPU and what OS was this done on?
Yeah, we use basically C. This is straightforward porting of CPU program, and Yeah, it's basically C, and it has some extensions for parallel processing, but
wasn't OpenCL or CUDA or
we used CUDA.
Good. Okay.
What happened to there's a line of work like coming out of Intel and other research places like making network processors. What happened to that? Like, are they still like network processors that were supposed to do this kind of thing in a sense, like processing customized for packet forwarding and such things?
What I wanna say is network processor is not commodity. You can't buy a network processor at the cost of $500.
But what's the cost of a network processor?
I don't know.
It's a couple $1,000s.
That's it?
But they're not, but they're also, substantially less parallel. I think they're something like 16-way, 32-way, rather than 500-way.
Network processors are going out of fashion. I mean, it like Optane Cavium processors, and they're still doing well in ATCA chassis. But first, it's hard to get. So you need to have like design a board with the network processor in. So it's not commodity. It's not readily available knowledge, just like graphics card.
So I think like GPUs are going to make network processors obsolete?
Don't know. But network processor market is not that big anyway. And the programming network processors is very hard. So the failing to provide a programming environment that's like graphics processors, the companies have done, it's a one major weakness to of network processor market.
So should I worry about reordering or any such thing? This or
reordering? Yeah. My answer is no. There is no reordering in this system. And if you ask why, then I should have prepared the backup slide, but today
no.
The answer was, basically, some reordering can happen, but okay, package in the same flow will not be reordered. And package.
So the possibility of packets being reordered takes place from the NIC to the queues in the memory, so in the driver. So from the NIC, the packets are sent to these queues, okay, the driver. Only that's when the reordering can place. So a packet, like packet number 1234 arrived at the NIC, and one goes to Q1, two goes to Q23. And out of those 1234 packets, they might actually go to 1234 might come out not in order, but out of order. But when NIC sends packets to these queues, then it's actually receiver side RSS support. Basically, they do this 5-tuple support at the NIC. So packets from the same flow actually go to the same queue. So packets from the same flow are never, then all the GPU processing, that's all done in order. So only at that part, there's a room for reordering, but not for packets from the same flow.
So the batch goes in and comes out in the same order? That's enforced?
The GPU, the shading process, the pre-shader, the shader, and post-processor, it's all in order.
So what exactly did you code the GPU out? For forwarding, it seems like you could do it in one shot. Like for each packet, you have one operation that happens on the GPU. But it seems like things like checksum checking would also be parallelized. So then you might want to do two things on the packet. You might want to do checksum checking.
Yep. Basically, we do something like that for IPsec tunneling, because we do AES and SHA-1. And this is done in separate stages. So we can do two things, not just one. Yeah, in the shift.
Or is it?
Yeah, why not three? Yeah.
I mean, so it's general. It's not. Okay, that was the question. Yeah. So when you can you go to the graph about the IPv6 forwarding? Yeah, this one back. No, the other way. One forward. So is this assuming that you're doing a forwarding lookup per packet, or is this, or are they? I mean, like. You would only, how many destinations? I mean, the average router only has a few thousand active destinations in it or something like that, right? And you could cache them. Does that mean that this is not happening except for like one in, you know, 1,000 packets? Or is it the case that you're going to actually do a lookup every time? What's going on?
Yeah, this is basically the worst case of IPv6 forwarding. We have enough number of prefixes in the system, and every packet received by PacketShader has different destination IP addresses.
It's worst case, both from the incoming stream and also with the routing table, because actually with an IPv6 routing table, you probably would see less entries than an IPv4 one because you have more of constellation of routes.
So IPv6, there's no realistic forwarding table that would be challenging. So it's randomly generated, while IPv4 is more a reflection of the today's router operation.
But presumably a very, very high percentage of your routing lookups are going to be served from a cache, right? Not from actual lookup in tables. Is that wrong? So you're not gonna. So especially if the IPv6 lookup is expensive, you would just cache the last 500 active flow, actual destination lookups somewhere.
But then in real routers, you just cannot deal with different, fast lookup and slow lookup for packets. So you have to basically put the entire forwarding table onto the line card, however you implement.
But yeah, this isn't a real router, right? This is a software router, so.
Right, you want to make it as real as possible.
But why would you penalize yourself? Okay, fair enough.
Thank you.
All right.